The next speaker, Anne Hendricks. Anne is assistant professor at Gant University and group leader at the Cancer Research Institute of Gant in Belgium. She obtained a Master of Science in Bioscience Engineering in 2005 and a PhD in Health Science in 2010. Anne Hendricks is the organizer of the EMBO and EMBL practical course on extracellular vesicles from biology to biomedical applications. And she is president of the Belgian Society of Extracellular Vesicles. We couldn't have wished for anybody better to tell us about EV in liquid biopsies, from technological considerations towards biomarker discovery. And it's up to you.
So first of all, thank you to the organizers for inviting me to this webinar. I have already very much enjoyed the previous two talks, so I want to thank Michael for already introducing extracellular vesicles. And I will further continue on the theme of Michael and Joe to further highlight the importance of standardization if we want to develop biomarkers into clinical applications. And of course, I will take it again from the perspective of extracellular vesicles. So if we want to develop extracellular vesicle-associated biomarkers, we have to consider the complexity of the liquid biopsy that we are actually using. So blood is one of the most commonly used liquid biopsies to develop extracellular vesicle-associated biomarkers. And if we take an in-depth look to the composition of this biofluid, we understand that there are different types of particles that we have to consider if we want to analyze extracellular vesicles. So besides extracellular vesicles, there are of course platelets, but also abundant protein, protein aggregates, cell-free nucleic acids, and lipoprotein particles. So if we want to study the content of extracellular vesicles for biomarker purposes, we need to be able to capture them out of this complex mixture. And this is mainly hampered by protein aggregates and lipoprotein particles that share different biophysical and biochemical characteristics with extracellular vesicles. A second complication for the field is that there are multiple methods available to separate extracellular vesicles from liquid biopsies. So extracellular vesicles can be separated based upon their size by making use of differential ultracentrifugation, size exclusion chromatography, or ultrafiltration. They can be separated by exploiting their density, making use of density gradient centrifugation. We can also capture them based upon the presence of specific surface antigens. And finally, there are also some polymeric precipitation solutions available that allow to precipitate biological materials that are residing in a liquid biopsy. Now, these are two key considerations: the complexity of the biofluid and the multitude of methods that are available. So one of the first questions that I asked when entering the field, now already 11 years ago, is there a certain impact of the choice of the separation method on the downstream biomarker analysis of extracellular vesicles? So to kick off this question, we developed an easy proof of concept experiment starting from a very simple liquid biopsy, cell culture supernatant. So we collected cell culture supernatant from a cell line and we prepared extracellular vesicles, making use of three commonly implemented EV separation methods, namely differential ultracentrifugation, where we pellet extracellular vesicles at a high centrifugation speed, density gradient centrifugation, where we allow to float extracellular vesicles towards their intrinsic buoyant density, and then a commercially available kit, ExoQuick, which is implementing polyethylene glycol to precipitate extracellular vesicles from a sample. So we collected the different extracellular vesicles samples and analyzed their content at the RNA level. What we observed is that when separating extracellular vesicles based upon the density-based method, the RNA content is completely different from the extracellular vesicles obtained by ultracentrifugation and the commercial exoquick method. Then, of course, the question arises, how is this possible? What we decided to analyze is whether certain methods co-separate different types of extracellular particles. And one of these particles are argonaute-2 ribonucleoprotein complexes. And indeed, as indicated here by Western blot analysis, we could observe that density gradient centrifugation resulted in an enrichment of the EV-associated protein TSG101, but there was no co-separation of argonaute-2 ribonucleoprotein complexes. This in sharp contrast to the ultracentrifugation and the exoquick method, where we had co-separation of both types of extracellular particles. So we know that different methods separate extracellular vesicles to a different level of purity or with a different level of specificity. So we decided to have an in-depth look into publications that were published between 2010 and 2015 to see on the different or to analyze the different types of methods that they implement to obtain extracellular vesicles from different types of biofluids. So we analyzed over 1,200 publications for 115 experimental parameters related to the separation of extracellular vesicles. These parameters are indicated in green, and to their particle and protein characterization indicated in blue and purple. We could observe that actually those publications reported more than 1,000 unique separation protocols, which is of course an issue if we know that the separation protocol influences the composition of the EV sample. Secondly, we also noticed that almost 20% of the publications did not perform any characterization of the extracellular vesicle samples that they are analyzing in their study. So this steered us towards the development of a supporting ecosystem to be able to mature extracellular vesicles as biomarker into clinical applications. There is a need in transparency because there are multiple methods available to separate extracellular vesicles. So if we want to reproduce those results, we need to be able to implement the correct methodology that was used to identify the biomarkers. We are also in need in reference materials that can help us to optimize methods that we use to separate extracellular vesicles, but also to normalize data between different patients and time points. And of course, we are in need of standard operating procedures that allow us to separate extracellular vesicles from liquid biopsies for biomarker discovery. Towards these aims, a first effort that we made was the development of the freely accessible online toolset EVTrack, which is an online knowledge base to stimulate transparent reporting and centralizing knowledge on extracellular vesicle research. So one of the main aims of this knowledge base is that we try to stimulate researchers to upload the material and methods section of their manuscript to the EVTrack knowledge base prior to submitting their article to a journal. In return, they will receive an EV metric, which is a measure for the level of transparency in reporting the material and methods section. The authors can use this EV metric as a coaching tool to improve the reporting in their material and methods and thus increase the reproducibility of their study. Once the study has been published and is accessible on PubMed, for example, the study will also become available online on the EVTrack knowledge base, which means that we are also able to follow increasing knowledge on extracellular vesicle biology and also to follow trends in methodology that is being used to study extracellular vesicles in liquid biopsy. And all this knowledge can be freely queried online. So the implementation of the EVTrack knowledge base is endorsed by the International Society for Extracellular Vesicles, and it is also one of the recommendations of the MICEF 2018 guidelines. Second effort that we made was the development of a reference material for extracellular vesicles, which we refer to as recombinant extracellular vesicles, or REV. Now, why are we in need of reference materials? First of all, reference materials can help us to optimize the methods that we use to separate extracellular vesicles from liquid biopsies. They can also help us in understanding the impact of different pre-analytical variables on downstream EV analysis. They can further provide or help us with calibration of instruments that we use to characterize or quantify extracellular vesicles. And of course, they can also help us with data normalization or mitigate for technical errors to be able to compare results of patient samples between different time points and between different clinical laboratories. So we decided to develop a recombinant extracellular vesicle as a reference material that was of a biological origin. To achieve this, we overexpressed the HIV-1 GAG protein, which is fused with the green fluorescent protein, in HEK293 T cells. This results in the generation of highly fluorescent extracellular vesicles that share different characteristics of endogenous extracellular vesicles. So they have a similar size and density range. They express different transmembrane proteins that are characteristic of endogenous extracellular vesicles. They have a similar lipid membrane composition and also characteristic intraluminal proteins. Nevertheless, we are able to distinguish these reference materials from endogenous extracellular vesicles at multiple levels. First of all, we are able to quantify the recombinant extracellular vesicles based upon their fluorescence intensity, making use of a fluorescent plate reader, fluorescent nanoparticle tracking analysis, or high-resolution flow cytometry. Secondly, we can also analyze them or quantify them based upon the presence of EGFP messenger RNA by qPCR, and we are also able to quantify them based upon the presence of the HIV-1 GAG protein, making use of a P24 ELISA assay. So what are the uses of these recombinant extracellular vesicles? So one of the main aims is that we are able to spike them in liquid biopsies prior to any processing, and that after obtaining the EV samples, we are able to correct for technical errors that occur during separation or between different users or between different laboratories, for example. Here we performed a small proof of concept experiment where we obtained blood plasma samples from healthy donors and early stage breast cancer patients. The blood plasma samples were spiked with a defined number of recombinant extracellular vesicles, and the extracellular vesicles were extracted from the blood plasma samples, making use of our SOP, which I will explain later on in this presentation. In the one on the left-hand side, we can see the condition where we did an absolute quantification of the number of endogenous extracellular vesicles in those blood plasma samples. Here we do not identify a difference in the number between healthy donors and early stage cancer patients. However, after normalizing for technical variations that occurred during the separation and between different users, by normalizing for the numbers of the spiked recombinant extracellular vesicles, we did identify a significant increase in the number of extracellular vesicles already in an early disease stage. Okay, so we have transparency, which is important for reproducibility. We have reference materials that can help us to optimize standard operating procedures. So the next step is which standard operating procedure will we use to search for extracellular vesicle-associated biomarker in blood plasma samples. As I indicated in the beginning, it's important to consider the complexity of the liquid biopsy. So in this particular case, blood. On the left-hand side, you can see an indication of the different types of extracellular particles that you have to consider when separating extracellular vesicles from blood. These different particles are indicated in terms of their size and density, and reveal that there is a certain frame in which we are able to separate extracellular vesicles from protein aggregates and different types of lipoprotein particles. So the protocol that we developed is as follows. We start from 2 ml of platelet-depleted citrate plasma, which we load on top of a size exclusion chromatography column. This method will first elute larger particles, including extracellular vesicles, and then elute the smaller particles, such as HDL particles and soluble proteins, which means that by implementing size exclusion chromatography, we will be able to separate extracellular vesicles from HDL particles and soluble proteins. Then we collect the fractions that contain still the extracellular vesicles, which is here indicated in orange, and we refer to as the crude extract, and we load the crude extract on top of an OptiPrep density gradient. This gradient is centrifuged for 18 hours and allows the extracellular vesicles to flow to their buoyant density. And this will allow us to separate the extracellular vesicles from protein aggregates that flow to higher density fractions and also from the lower density lipoprotein particles that are retained in the top fractions of the gradient. Now, size exclusion chromatography is commonly implemented as a standalone method. So as a proof of concept, we decided to compare the protein content of the extracellular vesicle extract, indicated in green, with the protein content of the crude extract, indicated in orange, and with the protein content of the lipoprotein extract, indicated in red. Mass spectrometry-based proteomics revealed that the protein profile of the extracellular vesicles differentially clusters from the protein profile of the crude extract, so the sample that eludes after the size-based method only. What is more strikingly is that actually the protein profile of the crude extract resembles more the lipoprotein profile, which are the top fractions of the density gradient, than it resembles the EV extract, meaning that with the size-based method only, we are not able to identify extracellular vesicle-associated protein biomarker in a similar depth as we are able by combining it with the size and density approach. Next, we implemented the standard operating procedure to explore the protein landscape of extracellular vesicles across different disease conditions. So we collected blood plasma samples from breast cancer patients, ovarian cancer patients, and HIV patients, and separated the EVs, making use of the size and density-based method, and analyzed the EV composition, but also the lipoprotein extracts at the protein level. First of all, we identified different proteins that are characteristic of extracellular vesicles like CD9 and CD1, and we identified these proteins across the different clinical conditions. On the right-hand side, we performed a correlation analysis of the protein profiles, which revealed that extracellular vesicles do contain a disease-specific protein composition, while this is not observed for the lipoprotein particle fraction. Next, we also collected serial blood plasma samples from ovarian cancer patients. So in this particular example, we had 4 ovarian cancer patients that we followed over 5 serial time points. We again analyzed the extracellular vesicle samples and the lipoprotein particle extract by mass spectrometry-based proteomics. First of all, we observed that the extracellular vesicle extracts, the proteins, cluster together across the different patients and across different time points, again confirming that the proteins that we identify in the lipoprotein extract significantly differ from the protein composition in the EV extracts. Below, on the right-hand side, you can see a correlation matrix of one patient over the multiple time points, which reveals that the protein composition of extracellular vesicles changes upon therapy or therapeutic intervention over the different time points, and this change is not observed in the lipoprotein extract. Furthermore, we observed that actually the extracellular vesicle pattern changes after surgical intervention, which is at time point 2 indicated in this graph, and whereas the lipoprotein particle composition only altered based upon the fasting status of the patient. So indicating that extracellular vesicles do contain a disease-specific protein composition and that this protein composition changes upon therapeutic intervention. Now, while we were studying the different fractions of the standard operating procedure that we developed, so what we always typically do, as is also recommended by the MISTEF guidelines, is that from all the different fractions that elute from the size-based method, and also all the different fractions from the density gradient method, that we do an in-depth analysis. So we always use all the different fractions as a control condition. And in this particular situation, we were identifying bacterial proteins and RNAs in a higher density fraction to where we normally identify eukaryotic extracellular vesicles. So we were hypothesizing that maybe in certain disease conditions, we were able to identify bacterial extracellular vesicles. To further investigate this, we implemented a LAL assay, which is able to quantify the presence of LPS, characteristic of gram-negative bacteria and their extracellular vesicles, across the different size-based fractions and density-based fractions. We identified high endotoxin units in the crude extract, indicated in orange. We identified also high endotoxin units in the LPP extract, but LPS is known to be neutralized by lipoprotein particles, so it's not surprisingly. And we also identified high endotoxin units in the higher density fraction indicated in blue, but only in those cancer patients that were encountering an intestinal barrier dysfunction upon chemotherapeutic or radiotherapeutic intervention. To further confirm the presence of bacterial extracellular vesicles, we combined a proteomic analysis, which revealed the presence of outer membrane proteins, inner membrane proteins, and cytosolic protein, characteristic of both gram-negative and gram-positive bacteria. We implemented different assays to characterize different pumps. So, for example, different assays for lipopolysaccharide, but also for lipotychoic acid, for gram-positive and gram-negative derived bacterial extracellular vesicles. And electron microscopy further validated the presence of bacterial extracellular vesicles, making use of a gold labeling for OMP-A protein. So what we decided to do next was to evaluate in which particular disease conditions we were able to identify the systemic presence of bacterial extracellular vesicles. So we selected collected blood plasma samples from HIV patients, inflammatory bowel disease patients, and cancer patients receiving radiation or chemotherapy and encountering intestinal barrier dysfunction. What we observed was that the presence of systemic bacterial extracellular vesicles was increased in each of these particular disease conditions compared to the respective healthy controls. So in conclusion, I think the main message for me today is that extracellular vesicles in blood carry multiple types of interesting biomarkers that can be exploited for development of new novel clinical applications, but it is challenging and there are different considerations that we have to take into account. First of all, there is a different number of separation methods and also combinations thereof that are increasingly used and available, but they separate extracellular vesicles with a different level of specificity and recovery. we need this variety. I am convinced that we need this variety in metals because we still do not know much about all the different types of extracellular vesicles that are present in blood. What about the heterogeneity? What about their different functions, their different biomarker profiles? So we are in need of a variety of metals. But of course, if we want to end up with results that can be translated into clinical applications, we have to be transparent in reporting what we do. So MICEF guidelines, or following the instructions of the MICEF guidelines, seems crucial to first of all analyze the presence of different extracellular vesicle associated biomarkers, but also to transparently report your material and method section. This can be assisted by the use of the EVTrack knowledge base, which we developed with the aim to stimulate researchers towards transparency and also to increase the awareness of different parameters that have a potential influence on the analysis of extracellular vesicle associated biomarkers. The SOP that we developed to continue our analysis of extracellular vesicle associated biomarker combines two biophysical characteristics, namely size and density, that allow us to separate extracellular vesicles with a high specificity and repeatability from different types of other extracellular particles like lipoprotein particles and protein aggregates. Using this SOP, we demonstrated that extracellular vesicles carry a clinical context-dependent but also a time-dependent protein composition. And I think the most crucial message is that we could have implemented a simple commercially available kit and managed our separation in 1 hour. Now it takes us 18 hours to analyze only 6 samples. But by doing this very extended SOP, we were able to make a novel discovery, which I am convinced would not have been able with other more simple kits or separation methods available. So sometimes it is worthwhile to research your samples in depth. Although my focus in this presentation was on blood, similar recommendations are, of course, applicable to other types of biofluids that are used for biomarker discovery, including fecal samples, tumor-conditioned medium, and urine samples. If you want to learn tips and tricks on how to separate and characterize extracellular vesicles, I'm happy to announce that we decided yesterday that we will run our EMBL EMBO course in March 2022 in person. So the registrations open this week, so feel free to register and attend the course. And with that, I would like to thank my collaborators. Thank you for your attention, and I'm happy to answer your questions.